A reading from the Gospel according to John. Jesus said this to his disciples, "When the Advocate comes, whom I will send you from Abba God, the Spirit of truth that proceeds from God will testify to me. And you also testify, because you have been with me from the beginning. I have much more to tell you, but you cannot bear it now. But when the Spirit of truth comes, you will be guided to all truth. This Spirit will not speak on her own authority, but will only speak what she hears, and will declare to you the things that are coming. The Spirit will glorify me, taking what is mine, and declaring it to you. Everything that Abba God has is mine. For this reason, I told you that the Spirit will take from what is mine and declare it to you." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Land around the house was either covered with flowers or vegetables. So as we went walking to his garden, I said to her, "I just couldn't believe how many things are growing here." She looked at me, and then she reached right down and she grabbed a big handful of the earth. And she said, "I know this dirt like the inside of my heart. I could grow anything here." Another story. A couple of months ago, my sister Elaine was visiting. She's a professional chef, an excellent cook, and she was making a Korean dish with no recipe, just a little bit of this, a little bit of that. She put it on the table and it just tasted fantastic. And I said, "I don't know how you do this. How do you get just the right flavor?" She said, "I don't know how to do it, I just know it. I just know when it's right." A year ago, I went to a woodworking course. One man was going to the pile of wood, saying, "No, not this piece, not this piece, no, not this piece, not this piece." Finally, he said, "Here it is. This is the right piece." Being a novice woodworker, I said, "How do you know that's the right piece?" He said, "I don't know how I know. I just know this is the right piece." Perhaps all of you have had that feeling sometime, when you just know within you that this is the way it's supposed to be, or this is how you do it. It's like it's your knowledge, it's your talent, it's your skill, and you know inside you when it's right. Living in the Holy Spirit is like having that knowledge for every piece of your life, not just for cooking or woodworking or gardening, but for every part of your life, for your job, for your relationships, for your health, for your finances. It's knowing that you're connected to God in everything that you do. How do you recognize the voice of the Holy Spirit and know that it is the Holy Spirit's voice? Well, one thing we know is that the voice will always be loving. The voice of the Holy Spirit does not command because it is incapable of arrogance. It does not demand, because it never seeks control. It does not overcome, because it does not attack. It merely reminds. It is compelling because of what it reminds you of. The way of peace, the way of love, of compassion, of openness, God's way. One writer likened the Holy Spirit to the best GPS you could ever imagine. Imagine that the Holy Spirit is the most advanced GPS ever. Always accurate, never makes a mistake. You can't forget to bring it, because it's always with you. It's impossible for the Holy Spirit to go someplace that it doesn't know, because it knows everywhere. It doesn't have a battery. It never runs out. Its power source is the mind of God, and it always gives you the best direction. So what happens if you ignore the voice of the Holy Spirit? Does it give up? Does it tell you to make a U-turn? No. It's smarter than that. It doesn't care about the mistakes that you make. Its only concern is to get you back to your heart, and so it picks up exactly where you are and starts again. The Holy Spirit can bring healing to the wrong decisions that you make and get you on the optimal route. It is only interested in this very moment, not 20 miles down the road, and it doesn't care where you were last month. And so when the Holy Spirit is your guide, you can breathe. You can focus on where you are now. You can look around and enjoy the moment. You can let the Holy Spirit be in charge. There are three things that you need to do to allow the Holy Spirit to be in charge. The first is you need to listen to the voice of the Holy Spirit. This morning I got up early to get ready for Mass, but as I always do, wanted to go over my homily. So I went into the kitchen to pick up my homily, and there it was, all soppy, wet, covered with milk. I immediately thought to myself, who spilled I found myself really upset as I'm pulling these pages apart, seeing the ink smeared on them. So I go into the living room and I start retyping it, kind of like I just know. And of course, I'm typing this song about breathing in the Holy Spirit. Give me guidance. And I could just feel that peace just coming over. It's like this stuff just flowed out of me. And I just felt this peace coming. And I'm just like all of you, I have to remember, even when I'm preaching about the Holy Spirit, I have to remember to ask the Holy Spirit for the help. And once I do, everything changes. Everything changes. It is a voice that doesn't get angry or upset with you. The Holy Spirit is a steady voice, able to be heard over noisy children, over television, or violence, or any distraction in your life. The second thing we need to do is also simple. We need to take the instructions that the Holy Spirit gives us. Do what it says. This morning, after breathing in the Holy Spirit, I found myself changing my homily thing, so you can get the revised version last time. And I believe that's because the Holy Spirit was guiding me in a different way. If you want to take a break from listening to God, that's fine. God will wait until you're ready. And sometimes I want to do that because, you know what, I like what I'm doing, and I don't want God to interfere with it. And I'll look out and tell me something else. Because I don't know if I want God involved. Sometimes I just have to ask God to help me listen. Simple as that. God, just help me listen to you. We always have a choice. We can listen to the Holy Spirit, or we can listen to the other devotions in our life. And I call them devotions because we do have other things that we give priority to over God. Other things we give power to, we give our heart to. And so sometimes we might even have to name that for ourselves. What am I giving my devotion to? Where is it going? How do I know if it's the Holy Spirit and I'm not just making this up? Well, the scriptures tell us that it will be verified, that others will confirm that decision for you, and that your life will show the fruits of listening to the Holy Spirit. And what are the fruits that Scripture tells us will appear in our life? They are these: love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. If you find your decisions bringing you to these qualities, even though there may be turmoil around you, then you know you are listening to the Holy Spirit. On the other hand, if you find yourself filled with worry, anxiety, stress, jealousy, envy, resentment, then it might be time to pause and listen again. This is the gift that Jesus gives his disciples in his last visit with them. He says, I am going to give you the Spirit. I physically won't be with you, but the Spirit will be with you. The Spirit will be your teacher and your guide. And then he says to them, do not leave the city until it comes. Wait for the Spirit. And that is the third thing that we need to do. We need to wait. There are many times when we pray to God. We pray every day, and nothing happens. And so we pray again, and still nothing happens. And so we find ourselves waiting. We might be waiting for that job that we need. We might be waiting for that significant person in our life, like Don Novak told us last week in her Mother's Day offering. We might be waiting for healing for our illness, or recovery from our addiction. We might be waiting for peace or reconciliation. When Corpus Christi was dismantled, it took 6 months before Spiritus Christi began again. It took 6 years for World War II to end, 28 years for the Berlin Wall to come down, 94 years for the 15th Amendment giving African American men the right to vote, and 95 more years before the Voting Rights Act would enforce that amendment. It was 141 years for women in the U.S. to have the right to vote. Unless you lived in Mississippi, then you had to wait 66 more years until it was ratified in 1984. Sometimes we have to wait, not give up, because moving a mountain can take time, but it does happen. This morning, Joseph Warren, where are you, Joseph? Where's Joseph? This morning, Joseph Moore told me that he had received in the mail his approval for residency in the U.S. He's been waiting 30 years.
You might say, I'm just a gardener, but the
Holy Spirit would say, no, you are a partner with God. You plant seeds, pull out the weeds, and prune the trees. God makes them grow, gives them beauty, fragrance, taste, and purpose. When we live in the Holy Spirit, the meaning of our life becomes clear and apparent to us. And it's a much deeper meaning than what we might realize without the Spirit. So how do we get closer to God? God is already close. God is already present. All we need to do is pause, be aware, and listen. We think we are on our own, but I assure you, we are not. We can ask the Holy Spirit to guide us, to show us things we do not see, to reveal to us things we do not understand. This weekend we celebrate our 20th Pentecost together. We've been through a lot together. Much of it was okay, some of it was not okay, but ultimately it was all okay. For if God is with us, all is well, and all shall be well, and all manner of things shall be well.